Hey, Dr. Backman here. Let's talk about transferring files between Unix-like computers using SCP. That's the Secure Copy Protocol. Okay, let's go. If you're familiar with the copy command CP that you'll use in the terminal of Unix-like systems such as Linux or macOS, then learning to move files from one computer to another computer with SCP will be pretty easy to pick up. And that's because SCP follows the same basic conventions the CP uses. To copy a file with CP, you need to specify two things. One, what you want to copy. And then two, where you want to put the copied item. We call the item you want to copy the source, and the location to place the copied item the destination. If you're unfamiliar with using CP to copy files or how to identify the path of a file, it's worth checking out my prior video on basic Linux navigation first. But before we jump in, I'm assuming you're already in a position to remotely log into a particular computer with a specific user account. We typically do this with the program SSH. If you're able to SSH into a remote computer, then you'll be able to move files to or from that computer using SCP. Now, let's talk through and visualize an example. Suppose I've got two computers, my laptop here on the left, and then a remote computer they may not have physical access to on the right. I'm also showing some of the files that exist on these computers in my user account's home directories, just to make things a little bit easier and to visualize the process. Now, let's suppose that we want to transfer the starter-code.cpp file from the laptop that I'm currently using over to the remote computer. That file currently lives on my laptop in the documents directory within the home directory denoted by the tilde. By saying all that out loud, we've just identified the path of the source. That's /documents/starter-code.cpp. Great. Next, we need to identify the destination and figure out where we want to put this file. I'd like to put it in the homework 2 directory within the CMSC182 directory of my home directory. That's a lot of directories. But that's where this path is, that's where we want the file to go. Let's just suppose that this is some sort of starter file, starter code, that will allow us to get going on the homework 2 assignment of our CS2 course. For us, that's CMSC182. So, we've now identified the path for the destination. /CMSC182/HW_2/starter-code.cpp. Again, great. However, if we're typing this into the terminal on the laptop, nothing about that destination path identifies that this path should be applied to the remote computer. So, let's take a quick detour to talk about how we identify and log into remote computers. If you want to connect to a remote computer with SSH, you typically specify two things. One, the computer's address, and two, the username to log in with. Spelled out, that would look like username@computer-address. As an example, on my local network, my remote computer's hostname is K, K-A-Y. So I can type in Backman, that's my username, at K. In full, I would type in SSH Backman@K. If you haven't set up a host name for your computer, you'll need to rely on the IP address of the remote computer to type in instead. For me, that would be SSH Backman@10.92.21.15. The username and address component is the important missing piece for our destination path for that SCP example we talked about just a bit ago. The complete destination path would look like username@address:path. For our example on the server I identified, that would be backman@10.92.21.15:\CMSC182/HW_2/starter-code.cpp. Sometimes it's nice to type these things rather than say them. And that's everything we need as we're defining the computer, the relevant user account, and the path on that computer to place the copied item. Perfect. To wrap up this example and type out the full command of the form SCP source destination, we'll have SCP /documents/starter-code.cpp, Backman@10.92.21.15:\CMSC182/HW_2/starter-code.cpp. And now we hit enter. If this is your first time ever connected to a server with SCP or SSH, you might be prompted with a notice that asks if you would like to connect to and remember this server. Otherwise, you might immediately see a prompt to authenticate to this computer by typing in the password for the username you provided. After doing that, you should see the list of items that are copied printed to the screen with status bars depicting transfer speeds and completion times, and then your files will have been copied. Success. So remember, the general format is to type SCP, then identify what you want to copy as the source, and then identify where you want it to go as the destination. Should the source or destination be on a remote computer, you'll need to prefix onto that source or destination the username and the computer address to make that remote connection. Let's try another example in which I try to fetch an entire directory for my remote computer and then place it on my local computer. Just like CP, if you're copying directories, you'll need to add a -r up front to denote that you'll be recursively copying the contents of the directory. In this scenario, the source item will be a directory on my remote computer, so I'll provide my username, Backman, then @, and then the address of my remote computer. For me, that's 10.92.21.15. Then I'll type :, and identify the directory I want to copy. In this case, it will be /cmsc182/hw_1, the homework one directory. Since I want to copy this directory to my local laptop computer, I don't need to prefix the path with a username or computer address. It's local. I can just type directly where I'd like to place it, and let's just assume that that's directly into my home directory. So, in this case, I can let the destination be /hw_1. This looks good. We've identified a remote source and a local destination. Let's hit enter. And the file transfer is complete. Again, the process is pretty similar to using CP. We still just identify a source and a destination. The only difference with SCP is that we also include a username and an address if either the source or destination are remote. And now you know how to use SCP. There are other programs you can use that simplify this a bit and make things a bit more drag and drop friendly, but underneath, this is the premise at work. And if you want to do it from a terminal or write scripts that move files between computers, now you know how.